today's video, we're going to do a nice little car ride, and I'm going to drive. I need to go grocery shopping, and I only got about 26 miles left in my car, so I'm going to supercharge in the grocery store parking lot. It's nice and convenient. So today's video will be talking about, or I should say, correction, I will be explaining to you the parts and features of the Tesla Model S and Model X thermal management systems. Now, I will note on the diagram shown, it is for a rear-wheel drive car, or Model S, and that's because a dual motor car for the Model S or X has an additional coolant loop for the front motor. The Model X is slightly different, but in general it's pretty much the same. Now with the Model 3 it is considerably different, and unfortunately I was not able to get diagrams for the Model 3 nor a dual motor Model S or X. So we're going to be working with a older diagram here, but you should still be able to get a very good idea of the layout and the information here. And I would love to do a Model 3, so if anybody out there has a Model 3 thermal management diagram, please pass it on over. Now, compliments to a great TMC or Tesla Motors Club member, Arnis from Estonia, for putting this all together and giving me permission to use it and change it a little bit for my video. I have a link to his TMC post in the description box below, so you can pop on over and see in a little more detail and also dig through that thread. So, first on our list is number one, the main coolant radiator. It does not have a fan. When the vehicle is moving, air passes through the coolant. Coolant enters from the right. This radiator can be bypassed with device number 10. This is important, as when temperatures are very cold, bypassing the radiator will keep your battery and motor from cooling further rather than warming up. Number 2, coolant circulation mode selector. A device that switches between two modes, series and parallel. If in series, coolant passes from 1 to 3 and then from B or battery to number 7. If it is in parallel, one loop passes from number 1 to number 7 and other loop passes from B to number 3. And just for purposes of this video, we will refer to as battery as B. Number 3, coolant pump, 12-volt coolant pump. The percent indicates pump's running speed. Slower pump speed uses less energy, prolongs pump life, and slows the coolant flow. Full speeds are generally used during supercharging and high performance, such as track use, high speeds towing, to help maintain cooling of the batteries. Number 4, adjustable coolant redirection valve. It sends 100% of coolant from number 3 to number 5, 100% from number 3 to number 13, or anything in between. Thermal management will determine this based on ambient temperatures, battery, cabin, and motor temps. Number 5, the coolant heater. The Model S and X are rated for 6 kilowatt resistive thermal heater for the battery pack, though they can also drop down and run as low as 3 kilowatt. The coolant heater is a resistive heater that runs on high voltage, so it runs off the pack voltage, not off the 12 volt auxiliary battery. Once activated, coolant will be warmed and begin to flow through the battery pack. This is used to heat the battery pack fast. Heat generated by number 6, 8, and 9 can also be used for pack heating through the use of those devices' waste heat, though that heating is minimal due to efficiencies of these units. A cold pack will also cool down those devices. The coolant heater can be disabled by activating the Model S or X's range mode. The coolant heater will bring the battery up to 32 degrees Fahrenheit or 0 degrees Celsius or slightly higher to allow regen and charging. If range mode is turned on, the coolant heater will not come on until approximately negative 10 degrees Fahrenheit or negative 23 degrees Celsius, saving a considerable amount of power if charging or regen is not needed. Opinion and my observations, in general, you will save more power by disabling / turning off the pack heater than you will gain by regen. Plugging in the car and starting charging will override range mode setting and heat the pack to needed temperature. It will draw power from the grid to heat pack while plugged in, or draw power from the pack itself if you are not. The number 6 DC to DC converter takes energy from the high voltage pack and steps it down to 12 volts. High voltage pack is roughly 350 to 404 volts fully charged depending on your battery and trim level. This keeps the 12 volt battery charged and all 12 volt devices powered up. A more limited amount of cooling is directed through this unit as heat generation is low and power output of this device is variable. So in other words, it only uses or converts what is needed to convert. So it generates less heat when it's converting less power. Number 7, another 12 volt coolant pump. This pump is required to keep the second loop of coolant flowing. If number 2 is in parallel mode, it acts as a backup to number 3. In series mode, both pumps run at equal speed. In parallel, pumps run at speed that is required for that specific system's cooling. Some early Model S's are said to have 3 pumps. My original Model S60, I was told, did when it was having pump number 2 replaced way back in 2013 by Tesla's mobile service. Design changes with Tesla are constant. Car will still be operational with a single pump failed. However, the car may run at reduced performance and services, and supercharging may be unavailable due to excessive heat buildup. The onboard charger, which is number 8, is used for vehicle charging. It converts AC grid electricity to suitable DC for main battery. Non-refreshed Model S vehicles were capable of having dual chargers, which were a master and slave charger combination for a maximum of 80 amps and 20 kilowatt charge rate. Starting with the refreshed Model S and Model X in 2016, Tesla removed this option and instead opted for a slower, single 48 amp charger or 72 amp charger for fast charge. The original optional dual chargers would be connected in series for cooling. There is coolant bypass as full flow of coolant does not need to flow through, and due to the limited size of the charger may restrict flow. Also, the chargers do not need to be cooled if the vehicle is not actively charging. Likewise, the chargers also do not need to be heated. Drivetrain. Coolant enters the motor, circulates in the stator, also circulates in the inverter or power electronics, and then exits with the temperature value shown. The transmission or reduction gear and differential doesn't require cooling, though it gets some heat as it's between the warm motor and the inverter, which raises the temperature of the oil and makes it slightly more efficient. Also, the rotor temperature shown most likely calculate estimation and inverter electronics temperature. Diagrams shown are for single drive unit cars. Dual motor cars would, of course, have a similar loop in the front of the vehicle for forward drive unit cooling. Number 10, adjustable coolant redirection valve. Same as number 4, either sends 100% of coolant through the radiator, bypasses 100%, or anything in between. If coolant is not directed to the radiator, it can be used to heat the battery. Number 11, AC condensers. They are required to cool down the refrigerant. These do have a fan. Fan speed indicated in percents. There are two condensers, each having a 12-volt fan. They are located between the fog lights and front of vehicle wheel arches. Air enters through louvers and exits the wheel arc. Louvers can be closed for better drag coefficient. Or in other words, if you don't need the AC or the car doesn't need it to cool the motor and battery, those louvers are closed, making the vehicle more aerodynamic. Number 12, electric air conditioner compressor. It runs on high voltage. It is used for two purposes: to cool the air for the cabin using 16, and or to cool the glycol loop using number 13. Percents indicate compressor running speed. If cooling requirements are very small, compressor will be temporarily stopped to allow cabin air evaporator to stay above the freezing point. Sensors before and after indicate temperature and pressure of the refrigerant before and after the compressor. Number 13, refrigerant coolant heat exchanger. Functions the same way as number 11 and number 16. But instead of air, it cools glycol coolant passing through it. While number 16 is not allowed to get below freezing, or 0 degrees Celsius, 32 degrees Fahrenheit, the chiller can go considerably colder, as coolant will freeze at much lower temperatures. Though it is more efficient to pass as much coolant as possible. Chiller can be disabled with number 14 to keep number 16 functional if user requests. Number 4 can also redirect only some of the coolant. In times of high demand for cooling car systems, vehicle will override user's request for HVAC air conditioning and limit cooling to the cabin in order to keep battery at safe temperatures. The only time this has ever really happened to me was driving through Nevada with it 120 degrees Fahrenheit in the shade, and then going and plugging in at the Nevada Las Vegas supercharger. That was the only time I believe I've ever gotten the reduction of cabin cooling, so that way the car could cool the battery. The chiller is also manufactured by Modine Manufacturing, located right here by me, just 30 minutes south in Racine, Wisconsin. I have attached a link to the Modine Manufacturing video when I did a photo shoot with them in 2013 and got to see the unit up close and personal while it was still a relatively secretive part of the car. Number 14, chiller activation valve is an on-off valve which either blocks the refrigerant from expanding into number 13 or not. Number 15, the cabin evaporator activation valve is an on-off valve that either blocks the refrigerant from expanding into 16 or not. Cabin air evaporator. Number 16, a radiator inside the HVAC system that cools the air that passes through. If climate control AC setting is on or pre-cooling is activated remotely, this will cool and dry the air that passes it. Air gets here through cabin air filter and continues to number 17. Number 17 is cabin air PTC heater element, rated for 6 kilowatt maximum power, which can be reduced by activating range mode through control settings menu. Runs on high voltage. Due to it being positive thermal coefficient device, it can generate 6 kilowatt of heat only if air enters that is very cold and moving very fast. If the element gets hot, it will reduce its draw even if it's activated to 100%. Usually air that exits doesn't get scalding hot no matter what. Temperatures between 55 degrees Celsius to 80 degrees Celsius or 130 degrees Fahrenheit to 175 can be expected at full power. Reduced power mode with range mode can greatly reduce the temperature of the heat on input air depending on input air temperature. Generally, range mode setting will still provide comfortable heat and considerably lower power consumption in external temperatures just below freezing and higher. Main traction high voltage battery. So we are now at B. Some data is shown on the picture. The trend temp trend is coolant temperature that enters the battery. If it is hotter, the battery will heat up. If it is colder, it will cool the pack. Coolant temperature after the pack is to the left below number 7. Number 19, minimum maximum cell temperature. Extreme values of the sensors in the pack. Lots of temperature sensors in the pack, one for each of the bricks of cells. There are 96 bricks of cells on an 85, 90, or 100 kilowatt hour battery pack. Number 20, or I should say, passing coolant target. That's not a number 20. Just my own numbering here. This is the value system ties to... let's start over again that one. This is the value the system tries to bring the pack to passively. If B is below this value, heat that has been generated by number 6, 8, or 9 will bypass number 1 and be absorbed by B. Active cooling target. This is the upper value for B temperature. If number 1 is not capable to cool enough and trend is to go above that value, active cooling measures will increase. This means number 14 activates number 13 and number 4 selects a portion of coolant to be chilled. Depending on requirements, number 13 speeds up, as will fans on number 11. So this is where you get your jet engine ready to take off sound when you are supercharging. At some point, if coolant is not capable to cope, other parameters can be limited, such as charging speed, vehicle regen, and power limits. Active heating target. This is the lower value for B. Anything below that and vehicle will use active measures to heat the pack. Apparently, number 5, it appears that active heating to that limit can be disabled with range mode. This will compromise battery charging capabilities and regen a lot, and also some of the power output until the pack warms up to its operating temperature. Once again, please see below video links and links forum links for more information. Don't forget, like and subscribe. Any questions, post below, and I will do my best to answer them for you.